In the last episode of Season 5, we looked into a Boulder, Colorado community then known as Divine Madness, whose members were recognized for some amazing results in ultramarathons. At the end of the episode, I mentioned that updates about the current status of the group were hard to come by. Recently, I was contacted by someone who wanted to let listeners know that they still pose a danger to those who come across their listings via organizations such as Worldwide Opportunities on Organic Farms, better known as WOOF. Welcome to Let's Talk About Sects, a podcast about cults around the world. I'm your host, Sarah Steele. Before we get into this episode, a content warning. This podcast deals with issues that some people may find disturbing, related to emotional abuse and controlling behaviours. This episode also includes mentions of sexual assault. Please use your discretion as to whether this will be suitable for you and those around you who may be listening to. Please also consider supporting this project via Patreon. Let's Talk About Sects is in its sixth season and has remained completely independent, and it relies on listener support to remain viable. Patreon.com/LTASpod. Now, on with the show. Daru Humans came across a listing for The Retreat in New Mexico on the WOOF website at the age of 25. Daru had previously spent time with intentional communities and organic farms, and was ready for a new experience. The photos of the scenic, secluded farm in the Gila National Forest were stunning. When I saw them, I wanted to visit too. Daru headed to the remote community in November 2022. During their stay, they started to notice a few red flags. A quick note that Daru was speaking with me from a designated wilderness area, so there are some small audio glitches, but I was pretty impressed overall with our connection. And if you haven't heard our previous episode about Divine Madness, I'd recommend you go back and take a listen to give you some greater context for the following interview with Daru.
So can you tell me how you originally came across this group?
So I first heard about them from the WOOF website, which is World Workers on Organic Farms. And I was looking for work trade opportunities in New Mexico. And they've got a farm, it's like 13 miles northwest of Reserve, New Mexico, in the Gila Forest. So I first found them on WOOF, and then from the WOOF website they redirect you to their website, which is teachingsofvalue.org. And that's where they have information about the farm in New Mexico, and they also have information about their community in Boulder, Colorado.
Sure. And so from looking at those materials, what was it that made you decide that you wanted to spend some time with this community?
So, I was interested in organic farming in general, is why I was on WOOF, but this community specifically is in a really kind of remote location. It's off grid. So they're doing self-sufficiency, growing a lot of their own food. They have their own energy source from a hydro plant on the San Francisco River. And then it's also a spiritual community. And from scrolling through their website, Teachings of Value, it gave me the impression that they are sort of an interfaith community, because they talk about drawing from various spiritual traditions and stuff. So I was kind of seeing it as being a broader spiritual hodgepodge situation, and not having one specific ideology or this is our religion or whatever. It felt like it was more open, which I was interested in. And then when you look into a little more into the internship, which is what they call it if you're a woofer, they also talk about there are specific times of the day set aside for your own personal spiritual practices. So it felt like, my impression was, it's this very kind of like DIY, do-it-yourself spirituality, and we just value that and hold space for that, but there's no, we don't ascribe to a specific thing. So that kind of, all of those things were things I was really interested in, and just living in community too, of course. So I was just interested in all of that and was going to be in the area, so decided to check it out.
Sure. And am I right in thinking that you were coming to this from having had, you know, other woofing experiences before or other intentional community experiences before?
Yeah, I was just coming from another woof farm. They actually picked me up. I was at a Coon Ridge Goat Farm, which is a really awesome farm out in the Cibola Forest, out kind of near Pie Town. So they actually met me halfway in the Sawtooth Mountains. I got dropped off by the first farmer. And then the people from, they call it the retreat, is like, so the people from the retreat came and picked me up at the Sawtooth Mountains. But yeah, I had woofed previously several years ago. And then I did a whole stint of woofing at like six places in New Mexico that year when I ended up at the Colt.
Sure. And so what were your first impressions when you arrived at the retreat, the New Mexico property?
So they have a tradition that when you first arrive, they drop you off at the entrance gate and you walk like not very long, like a half mile or something up to the property. So you get to walk along the river and just be immersed in this amazing, gorgeous river valley. And I came in the fall, so all the cottonwoods have beautiful yellow leaves, and it's the high desert, so it's got like the warm sun but the cool breeze, and it's just an extremely super gorgeous place and very idyllic. And then they have like a main community building where several of them live, and then there's a separate house where Yo, the teacher, lives, which I was instructed to not ever go in there. And then everyone else lives along the river in tents. There's like, I forget how many, like five or so ladies who all live out in tents out there, and the woofers do too. So yeah, it just seemed like really beautiful. They have a ton of acreage overall and a lot of empty fields and then several cultivated fields close to the house. So there's a ton of potential as far as farming goes. The hydro plant is super cool. I had never seen that. And then all the people are just extremely welcoming, and they just had a very like calm, kind, kind of quiet, but like open sort of energy. And they were also super hospitable because I showed up not knowing anything about what winter in the high desert is about to be like, because I think I got there in early November. So I was totally unprepared, like, especially for camping. So they gave me a ton of sleeping bags and like a better winter coat. And they were just very accommodating to make sure that I was like comfortable. So yeah, my first impression is just like really just immediately fell in love with everything about it, pretty much.
I can understand why. It sounds absolutely beautiful. And how many other people were there, and what was the demographics of the people?
So there was only one other woofer. She had been there for 7 months at that point. She's 22. And then the community members, there's 12 members, and then the teacher makes 13. And they had, I guess there was one member who'd been there for like 10 years, she'd been a part of it, but everyone else had pretty much been in it for 40 years. Like, they had been in it since the Boulder days, and some of those guys had been at the New Mexico spot since the 80s. That sounds wrong, but I'm pretty sure, I forget now, I'm not going to do the math right now, but they had been there for a super long time. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. And I guess I was also wondering about the gender demographics as well.
Mm-hmm. It was like 5 guys and 7 ladies were the core 12. And the teacher is male, and then the woofer was a young lady.
Right. And so, I mean, it sounds really extreme to me, staying in a tent through the winter. That actually sounds really difficult, but it's great that they set you up so that you'd be comfortable in those circumstances. I wondered if you could tell me about the kind of day-to-day activities while you were there.
Mm-hmm. So there was a lady who was kind of the manager, pretty much, and she writes out a weekly schedule for all 12 members and the woofers. So the schedule is like super busy, and there's just kind of always a lot going on, and you don't have a lot of free time. Every night we would all eat dinner together, the whole community, except the teacher. And then 3 mornings out of the week, we would do breakfast together. And then you had like 2 free breakfasts where you could do like a breakfast date with somebody. And then Fridays are the only day off in the week, and most people go hiking on Fridays. And then other than that, it's just a lot of like chores. Like, as a woofer, for me, it was all garden chores, but they have a lot of building projects going on. They're building a house, and every person kind of had their different roles of the stuff that they were working on. And they also, they used to do ultra running back in the 90s, and they still, most mornings they all go on runs, and some of the mornings they do long runs that are like 2 hours or something. And, you know, these are all people that are mostly in their 60s. So they're still pretty, I mean, they're hardcore athletes considering like the distances they're running and stuff. And it's like a lot of days of the week that they all go on runs in the mornings. And then in the evenings, there's always like some scheduled activity, either like, I can't remember what they called it, but it's like they would have a study evening for like personal development. And usually they would be watching recorded videos of the teacher giving his kind of like lecture, sermon, whatever you want to call it. And then like there was one evening, there was like a cleaning party to do a bunch more chores. And then there was one evening that would always be some kind of party. Like there were 2 dance parties that were super fun. And there was like a craft night party and stuff like that. So yeah, that was some of the activities that were scheduled in for everybody.
Sure. And so it all sounds quite scheduled. I suppose you had the hiking and the parties as sort of non-work times, but did you have any kind of downtime around all of those things that were scheduled?
Yeah. So most days of the week, you're pretty much scheduled from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And then there would be a 2-hour window of free time before dinner at 7. So unless you wake up early and get some time to yourself in the morning, you really only have 2 hours a day. And at that point, because we're also really almost in a river gorge, like it becomes a gorge when you go further back into the Frisco box, but we're in this valley where you don't see the sun rise or set. Like you're, and in the winter, your days are just so short. So by 5 o'clock, you know, it's already pretty much dark. So I would just have to like be in that main community building to do what I could with my 2 hours of free time, pretty much.
Right. Yeah. Cause you're sort of on this property away from everything. I guess I'm also wondering about the self-sufficiency aspect and how much contact there is with anyone outside of the community when you're in there.
Oh yeah. There's like no contact. It's extremely remote and cut off. You have to cross the river 7 times just to get to their property. So you have to have a special vehicle to even get there. And then Reserve, the closest town, is extremely small, and they don't really have any kind of social relationships in the town as far as I was aware. And they pretty much only leave to pick up like a big old, you know, post office run of whatever stuff that people bought on Amazon and packages and stuff, and bulk food and stuff. I kind of had a hard time telling how much of their food they did grow versus what they bought. It seemed like they grew a lot of their food because they also grew all their own beans, and most of the meals were kind of like beans and rice and oatmeal and stuff, kind of like basic hearty things. So yeah, they pretty much never left. Everyone got, they call it like a 7-day, and it's like everyone's supposed to get a yearly vacation that's 7 days that they get to be gone from the property. But I know that they didn't always get a 7-day every year either. Mm-hmm. So sometimes they would go for multiple years never leaving the property other than to maybe pick up supplies in either Reserve or the nearest that's more of a real town is Silver City, which I think is like 2 hours or so away.
Gosh, it sounds incredibly isolating. How long were you there all up? How long did you stay there in the end?
I was there for 6 weeks.
Sure. And so over that time, did you get any kind of impression that there was a structure to the community at all?
Mm-hmm. So there was a lady who was the manager, and then there was a lady who was kind of the main healer, because that was a huge basis of how things got started with the group, was that Yo, the teacher, he came up with this thing called the organ energy system, which is supposed to be a holistic healing practice, I guess, which they all assured me is the most holistic and better than all the others. And so there were two practitioners of OES at the Reserve property, and there were more at the Boulder community, but there was like a main healer lady who would do the arm pulls, which it's kind of like muscle testing, which is something they do in physical therapy, but instead of testing for the strength of the muscle, she would be testing for like how hydrated you are, what your childhood traumas are, like just any and every question that could ever arise. She would just tug on your arm and then tell you, oh, you're 96% hydrated and things like that. So she held a lot of influence over the group as a healer, and having this way of telling people what they need to do, supposedly because their bodies are providing this information, but really she's just telling people what to do. And they all very much believe that this is a healing art, and, you know, they take it as gospel. And then, as I mentioned before, everyone has their kind of roles. So there's the manager, there's the healer, there's the lady in charge of the gardening stuff. There is a super smart engineer guy who is in charge of the hydro plant, people in charge of building the house. And then there were some women they called the Ed girls, who had been teachers back when the cult had a school in Boulder. And now they're working on, to my understanding, compiling Yo's teachings to make, like, I don't know if it's supposed to be a Bible or like a school curriculum. I'm not sure really, but I think kind of both, but they're trying to create a better curriculum. Because I remember the one teacher lady told me that they just felt like they hadn't gotten it figured out when they did have the school. How, because, you know, they're also trying to teach the parents how to, like, raise their kids well. So it was kind of, you know, it was a very valiant effort, but they didn't get it figured out. So anyways, those ladies were working on that. And then there was also definitely a divide between this kind of inner circle of women who were, I mean, basically Yo's servants. Like, they would cook his meals, and they kind of had shifts being in his house. And, you know, I'm kind of glad that I don't know what all that entailed. But yeah, like, they would just take shifts being there overnight. And it was like five women or so. And then I think there was one woman who was like his main cook. And she just, I think, spent like all of her time over there during the day, it seemed like. And the healer lady had an office in his house and stuff. So there was like a main group of women, and they also, a lot of them had walkie talkies. Mm-hmm. So if he ever wanted or needed anything and they weren't at his house, he would call them up on the walkie talkie. Or there was even a few times during like the full community having dinner. Like, one time he called up on the walkie-talkie about some political thing. I can't remember, but he was like watching the news, and he called us up and said, oh, this thing is happening in the political world in the U.S. And yeah, we did like a channeling, like, group prayer about whatever the political thing. I don't remember if it was like an election going on or what, but anyways, that's kind of a side note. But yeah.
And I noticed you mentioned that that was via walkie talkie and he was up in the main house and you weren't allowed to go there, and the whatever the kind of teachings that you experienced of his were on recording. So were you seeing him much? What was your impression of Yo himself?
Yeah, so he was extremely reclusive and almost never left that house. The first time that I saw him, he was standing on the porch, naked from the waist down, of this house, just like standing there. And I think I was out in the field from a far enough distance that maybe he didn't see me. He's also blind in one eye. But yeah, so that was the first time I saw him. I was taken aback and like felt very uncomfortable. And I was already feeling uncomfortable about his existence because they don't mention on the Woof website. They didn't at the time mention on the Woof website that they had a teacher, and they don't mention it anywhere on the Teachings of Value website that they have a teacher. So I didn't know going into it that he existed. And when they picked me up to give me the ride down there, in the car, they told me, we have a teacher. And when they told me that, I pretty much immediately knew, like, oh man, I've got myself in a situation. But I kind of thought, well, I'll just stay away from him. And, you know, he doesn't have to be my problem. So that was kind of my policy going into it. And then, yeah, I saw him standing on the porch, and it just kind of, you know, like my heart dropped in my stomach. And I don't even remember if it was like an intrusive thought or a nightmare, but I kept like seeing him around in my imagination or in my dream. I can't remember. I was just very unsettled. And after I had been there for, I think, like 2 weeks, I came into breakfast one morning and the manager lady says, oh, we like to watch these videos with our breakfast, so we're gonna do that today. And she didn't really explain what it was or anything. So I just said, okay. And then they pull out their TV and it's this video that's the recording of Yo giving his teaching. And we started watching those like, I think 3 days out of the week, the 3 community breakfasts when we all eat together. So most of my initial impression of him was just through these teachings, because I hadn't seen him in person other than standing half naked on the porch. So it was very bizarre because I knew he was there and he's at that time 74 years old. And then I'm watching these videos that are, I think, from back in the 90s. So he's, you know, a lot younger. And they started out extremely innocuous. Like, basically, the teachings were eat healthy, exercise, go outside, which you really can't argue with that. So I was resistant to him and I was resistant to the videos. But when the teachings were like something that you can't really take issue with, I was like, well, all right, whatever. This is fine, I guess. And I just kind of went along with it. But as time went on, the teachings kind of got more and more concerning because he's, first of all, he says a lot of like racist, classist, ableist stuff. And there's a lot of teachings around like how your physical health is an indication of your emotional and spiritual health, which might sound like okay for some people, but the way that it was being used was very much as like a shaming, and like if you're overweight, it's because you're spiritually unfit or you refuse to face your inner problems of whatever your emotional issues are. And it was just like judgmental and bizarre and also very dismissive of like actual medical practice and intervention. Like people would be having real serious medical problems and being told like, it's psychosomatic, or you just need to hone in on your spiritual practice or whatever. So yeah, things kind of just got more and more weird. And he was also using the teachings just as a platform to justify his control over the community. And he had all these teachings about the ego that were basically like, just here's why I get to be in charge and you need to surrender to me. And yeah, as it went on with the teachings, it got harder and harder for me to sit through them. And I might be jumping ahead, but the teaching that finally had me deciding, okay, I can't watch these anymore was when he was describing an incident where there was like some kind of, you know, community weekend teaching event of some sort. And there was a woman who was in an abusive relationship. Her boyfriend was physically abusing her. And Yo, as a way of trying to like teach her or wake her up or whatever, he takes her up in front of the whole group, the whole community that's supposedly being taught. He takes her up in front of the group and he slaps her in the face and he says, "Hit me back." And she doesn't. And so he keeps slapping her over and over and over again until she finally hits him back. And the whole community sat in silence and watched him just hit this woman over and over and over again in front of the whole group of people. And in the video I watched, he's describing this event happening as like a story to explain some principle that he's trying to get across to people. But anyway, after that one was when I realized that I needed to tell them that I wasn't going to watch those videos anymore. So yeah, it was kind of a deteriorating impression. And I saw him standing naked on the porch like two or three different times. And then one time in the house, same thing, naked from the waist down, with the one lady in there with him who was always in that house. So there were enough things early on that, like, after I'd been there for really, I think, like only a week, I had the thought, I need to Google this guy because I bet he's a sexual predator. And I pretty much ignored that intuition because I didn't want to know, is really what it comes down to. I was just like, don't want to think about that. I'm just going to ignore that guy. And I just put it out of my mind, which in hindsight was super like dangerous and just really a bad call.
Yeah, I mean, I think I can understand that. And I guess particularly because you mentioned you had not had the impression of there being a teacher at all. So when you'd found that out, you'd kind of set in your mind that you were just going to ignore that aspect of the group and put it aside to your experience, which, yeah, it sounds like you wouldn't have gone there in the first place if you'd known that there was a teacher there. And is that because that's a red flag to you in the first place, or that's just not something that you were particularly looking for?
I think it is a red flag to me. I mean, obviously after the experience, it certainly is a red flag, but even before that, because I had been raised in a very authoritarian Christian environment. Ironically, you can't make this stuff up. My parents met in a cult, which was this Christian campus ministry called Maranatha. You can look into that. That's a whole different can of worms. But so I got raised, I mean, pretty much by that cult in a certain sense, because my parents took everything they learned from there and put it into the way they raised us. So because I had experienced religious abuse and this extremely authoritarian, I am the voice of God type behavior from people in positions of power, I already had a really bad taste in my mouth with the whole teacher, guru, you know, anyone who claims that they are like more evolved or closer to God and therefore the mouthpiece of God and all this stuff. You know, I already had strong negative associations with that. So for me, that's like, that would have been all it took to keep me away from there. But at that point in time, nowhere did it ever once mention that they have a teacher. And that's actually the one thing that did come from me reporting them to WOOF, is that WOOF required them to put on their bio that they have a teacher. So I hope that somebody gets deterred by that. But I think a lot of people are like, oh, like Eckhart Tolle or whoever, my somebody that I really look up to, you know, we all want and need guidance and mentors and stuff. So it's understandable that for some people that might even be a factor that attracts them, you know, that they're looking for somebody to help guide them and bring them spiritual truth and stuff like that. So yeah,
I think you're exactly right that it must feel frustrating for you personally that that's something that would have deterred you, but putting that information on the website is not really, it doesn't seem like it's enough of a warning about what's really going on there for other people who might come across the organization. And so you've covered this a little bit through what you've told me about the teachings and the structure and the healing. It was really interesting to hear you speak about the arm pulling exercise, because I remember reading about that when I was researching Divine Madness. And yeah, to have the description of that from someone who's experienced or witnessed it is really interesting. But I was wondering if there was anything else you wanted to share about the beliefs and the behaviors of the community members.
Yeah, so OES was kind of one of the bigger teachings, really the main one, because most of the other teachings were just like eat healthy and exercise and stuff that you don't really need to be told. So with OES, they call it balancing when they do, oh, how do I explain? It's like the muscle testing, like the arm pulls, but then they'll do it for muscles, meridian points, all these different parts of the body. So if a muscle tests weak, then that means that something is out of balance. And then you have to do something to balance that, which could, again, could be anything. So like one of the, and I was actually working with the main teacher or healer lady and doing like healing sessions or whatever. And so like, for example, one time when I was out of balance, according to this lady, she had me do pretending to have a conversation with my father as if he was in the room, and pretending to have a conversation with my mother as if she was in the room. And it was kind of this cathartic process of speaking my mind, which actually was very cathartic and helpful. So that was cool. There were a few sessions of the healing thing that were very interesting, and a few that really felt like pretty ineffectual. And yeah, it just became clear the longer I did the healing sessions and then watching different community members interacting with arm pulls and stuff, it became clear that this was mostly a tool for control more than anything. But outside of OES, they had some teachings that were almost like, it was all very lifestyle based. So there were a lot of little practices throughout the day, like they would do transitioning. So before you enter a building, you kind of stand and look at the earth around you and just like try to close the chapter of whatever activity you were just doing and open up to the next thing. They had another teaching called impressions, which was kind of similar, just taking in your environment and trying to really like infuse that energy into yourself and take it with you, which was my favorite teaching out of the whole thing. Impressions were super cool, just a way of like connecting to nature more deeply. They also just did a lot of meditation. And they would do these kind of meditative motions before running, sort of like a Tai Chi kind of thing. And it would be to get grounded and also kind of to dissociate as well. which would have been useful for ultra running to not feel the pain as much. Mm. And the whole teaching is like, you're connecting to the cosmos, and that's kind of dissociating from your body. And then you're connecting to the earth, and that's really grounding down into your sensations. So it's like a combination of those two things. And then as far as behaviors of the group, there were a lot of little ritualistic things, kind of like the transitions and the motions. They just had an entire culture of their own, and including like different language. They have all these different words for everything. And like, they eat on the floor, they sleep on the floor, they have mats instead of beds. None of them have doors to their bedrooms. They just have curtains that are pretty much always open. So there's kind of an extreme lack of privacy. And there's like the minimalist thing with eating on the floor. And also when you eat, it's kind of mindful eating. So they would do only two meals a day, two really big meals, and you eat them super slowly over the course of like an hour. And sometimes we'd like listen to music while we'd eat or watch a movie during dinner. So yeah, there was like just kind of embedded in everything they did would be this different language to describe it, or these different teachings and ideas underneath it. So that was another thing that fascinated me when I first got there. I was just kind of like, wow, what a cultural anomaly. Like, this is so interesting. And I was really trying to be just curious and open-minded and pretty much to assimilate to their culture, because I was kind of testing it out. Like, does this feel like it is a healthier way of life or not? You know, they also have like a set menu, like a weekly menu that never changes. So for dinner on Sunday, you're always going to have beans and rice every Sunday for the rest of your life, you know, like super, super exact and like replicated. So yeah, there's just a lot of little things like that. Yeah, I don't even know how to describe it. Just, it almost felt like being in a different country or something, the degree to which the culture was so different from just being in the US elsewhere.
Sure. And it sounds really interesting and quite regimented in a lot of ways. But as you say, there are always positive aspects to all of these organizations. You know, people aren't joining them because they're like culty from the outside. You've got a lot of really positive things that you're experiencing in groups like this. And I think that there's a lot to be said for open-mindedness in general, but then I guess it's yes, always worth being able to see some of those red flags, which clearly you were able to perceive, even though you were trying to be really open-minded as well. And so you've alluded to a couple of things already, but can you tell me what you think is dangerous about this community, this group?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, as far as just for everyone who's already there, the impact of the teachings and the impact of the control is like damaging to a degree that I can't even know. But like, especially with the weird health stuff, like there was a guy, all of the Boulder people came down and visited at one point. And there was a guy who was having real serious medical issues, like he was in the hospital and stuff. And everyone was being instructed to kind of just ignore him, and that he didn't need any kind of emotional support because he was going to have a victim complex or something. And his, whatever was going on with his health was a result of his emotional issues and stuff. And there was another woman who I think, I don't know, that she was just basically extremely underweight, like visibly underweight. And she was one of two community members who was still training for much longer, like ultra length runs. She would do like a 30-mile run every now and again while I was there. And just, yeah, malnourished, super underweight. And being given her diet directly from Yo, like he's telling her exactly what she can eat and when. And yeah, like as far as the control part goes, as I mentioned before, they almost never get to leave. A lot of them are completely cut off from their family. They don't talk to anyone outside of that community. They're also restricted for information in general. Like there's no library and the cell signal and Wi-Fi are super limited, which at the time I didn't know any better, but now I know there's such a thing as Wi-Fi calling. So you can use Wi-Fi to call people. And then there's also such a thing as Starlink, which is where you can get Wi-Fi even if you're in the wilderness. So they had said, oh, we have a limited bandwidth. And I had like a weekly call slot on their landline so I could talk to one person from the outside world once a week. And that was like my only access to any other perspective about anything. And it was the same with everyone. They had like a weekly call slot. And there was other teachings about not feeling your emotions. And this kind of came back around to it being portrayed as like spiritually unfit, like with the health stuff. So this was on the emotional thing. If you showed any strong emotions, you're immediately considered, oh, you're out of balance. And that's why you're acting this way. Like if anyone ever cried, they would like apologize and immediately stop crying. And like, if somebody was feeling strongly, they would be encouraged to like, basically shut those feelings down, push them down. And I kind of saw this happening in different ways with different people. And then there was also the restriction of, or I guess the control of partnerships. So who got to be in a like romantic relationship was determined by Yo. And you, I mean, I don't know what to say about that. Like, you could tell that people weren't happy, basically. And just in general, especially the women in the inner circle who were managers and stuff, they were constantly stressed out, especially the woman who seemed to be like his main servant or whatever. She just seemed like she was really not okay. And she was like, in some ways, even isolated from the rest of the community because she was just always at his house. They called the lodge, and she would even miss a lot of the community meals because she was over there cooking his meals for him and stuff. So yeah, and they were encouraged, like, or not encouraged, but prohibited from playing music. If like one of them was a musician, he wasn't allowed to play music because it was supposedly getting in the way of his spiritual practice or whatever. And having such limited time too, like the woofer was an artist and she loved doing visual art. And she told me she really missed doing it, but she just doesn't have time anymore because the day is so scheduled out. So there's just like a whole slew of negative impacts for people's mental and physical health who were participating. And the main danger that I can't speak to personally is the allegations of rape and sexual assault that were arising more so in the group's past, especially when they were getting a lot of press when they were doing ultra running and they were in Boulder. But there are a multitude of women who came out and said that Yo was a rapist and was coercing a lot of the women in the group to have sex with him. And I have no way of knowing, or I guess I'll say I have no evidence for while I was there that that practice is still happening. But I have no doubt that it was, and it's hard to explain, but from specifically that inner circle of women who were always like serving him, catering to him, cooking his meals, spending time with him, staying the nights in his house, there was an energy of stress, dissociation, everything you see with sexual trauma survivors with these women. But yeah, it was just really not good. And then the part I was most concerned about was this young girl, the other woofer, who was 22, and she was getting called to go meet with him in his home at 2 a.m. One of the ladies would come wake her up, and she would meet with him in the middle of the night, and it would be like by candlelight, and he's telling her that he's gonna show her her destiny and he's gonna mentor her and like teach her how to be, you know, spiritually evolved and all this stuff, and telling her to surrender and submit to him. And this is supposed to be some kind of spiritual ideology of surrender, but really it's like subservience to this human being. And yeah, I don't know. I don't think I can do justice to describe how everyone had this underlying sense of unhappiness, submission, learned helplessness, just beaten down. Like one, they also all had a lot of stories about in the past when they had left the group, they were like, I don't like this, I'm done with this, I'm leaving. And then they later came back. Multiple of them told me this, or instances where they were told, you need to leave. And then they had to like earn their right to come back. So there were many of them who had actually second guessed being there and somehow wound up back there, you know? So they had like their own history of resistance to this experience and had one way or another ended up back within Yo's control. And even like one person even said they weren't sure if they had ever made a choice, as in they didn't feel like it was a choice to be there. It was just something that they had no control over. So yeah, I don't know. It's hard to explain, and I feel like I can't really get it across, but just the degree of isolation, the servitude, the having no time to themselves, the sense of being surveilled by each other, like the lack of privacy. So everyone always knows exactly what you're doing and is in fact reporting that to the powers that be. Just a sense of your life is not your own to live. Like, you're living it for this other person, specifically living it for you.
I think you did a really good job of describing the dynamics and the dangers of it. And it's really common for people to leave and come back to these kinds of situations. I think a huge problem is that there's not a lot of understanding on the outside world for people who've been through these experiences, and there's not a lot of safety nets and places for them to turn. And then when you've isolated yourself from your family and quite potentially kind of maybe said some awful things to them as well, it can be difficult for you to even have loved ones on the outside to be able to turn to. So there are so many reasons why people fall back into these groups. And, you know, it's the same with abusive relationships. People fall back into them all the time. But yeah, the thing that did seem really concerning to me as well was exactly what you said, that you've got these young woofers coming to groups like this. And if this is the kind of thing that's going on, they're not offered any kind of protection from potentially predatory behavior. And so I wondered, as someone who's been through this experience, what measures do you think organizations like WOOF and the Foundation for Intentional Community should take when providing listings for communities like these on their sites?
Right. So on the WOOF website, you can leave reviews for hosts that you've worked for. And this is supposed to, you know, shine a light on, is this the good or bad experience that people have had here? And what I found out is that this is not really an airtight process by any means, because in my case with the retreat, they sent me to their website and I fill out an intern application. And then from that point on, we're communicating via email. So because they send you to communicate through a different website and through email, you don't go through the process on WOOF, which is that you send a visit request and the host accepts your request. So if that doesn't happen, you cannot leave a review. And they are actively sending people to their website to avoid going through that visit acceptance process so that people can't leave reviews. And then whenever somebody, you know, is there, most of the people who left reviews for the retreat on WOOF, they were there for like 2 weeks, a month tops. And a lot of the times they won't even show woofers these teaching videos if they're only going to be there a short while. So these people never experienced what I experienced. They know very little about how this community actually operates. And all they experience is, oh, what a nice garden, what a beautiful landscape. And so they leave these glowing reviews on WOOF. And they have, I forget how many, I think they have like 8 reviews that are just glowing reviews, 4 of which happened in the last year since I went there, which is kind of interesting to me. Mm. Makes me wonder if this is intentional on their part, since I did report them to WOOF. And I guess that's the next thing I would say is, whenever I reported them to WOOF, I explained to WOOF everything that happened to me, which I haven't even gotten into yet with you, but I ended up getting kicked out and there was a whole situation that went down. So I explained the way that I was treated, the rules for hosts that were violated by the cult. And then I also sent all these articles about sexual assault allegations against this leader. And when I sent this information, they said, okay, we're going to call them and ask them about it, which is wild because it's like, what are they going to say? Oh, yes, we are a cult. You figured it out, you know, like, so it's pretty much utter nonsense. And I guess at that point, it comes down to the he said, she said, and oh, you don't have any evidence for any of your claims, blah, blah, blah. So to me, what it comes down to is they need to actually enforce the giving people access to leave a review, because that's the only way right now that woofers have to determine, is this a safe place or not? Mm-hmm. For two, they actually need to enforce the rules for hosts. And if the hosts don't follow the rules, they should not be allowed on the site, on the WOOF website. Otherwise, what's the point of having a rule? And then the other thing is, I really think that they should do background checks on all the community members. And I'm sure their argument would be, oh, that's expensive. But if you think about it, every woofer pays $40 for a membership. That's a lot of money. And if you're running a background check one time for this host and you have, you know, okay, so they have those four reviews. So say there's five woofers that have been there in the last year, then that right there is $200. Plus, I don't know what the hosts pay, but you're getting that money from the hosts too. And that's just in one year, you're getting all this money, and a background check is like a one-time expense that I don't think is that expensive either. And I mean, shoot, that would probably save them from getting some kind of lawsuit from how many woofers have had really bad experiences, because I'm not the only one. And this isn't my only bad experience. I've had multiple experiences where the bio of a woof host is providing inaccurate information and false advertising. And again, there's no repercussions for hosts who falsely advertise. I went to a farm where the woman said she's a cattle farmer. I show up, there's literally no cows, not a single cow. And this happens all the time. And it's ridiculous. Like, and the hosts are in a position of power because it's their land. They're the ones providing the food and water and shelter. The woofer is in some ways completely at the mercy of the host because it's not their house. They don't get to make the decisions. It's not their food. Like, it's a really, if it's not a safe situation, you're really unsafe because your basic needs are not going to get met. Basic food, water, shelter, let alone if the actual physical safety is an issue, which luckily has only ever been a concern when I was at the cult and not in any of the other farms I've been to. But it seems like there's no recognition of the risk. There's no protection for woofers. It's really a mess. And I guess my other thought is, if they don't do background checks, then they should provide the name of every single community member so that the woofers can do a background check themselves, at least do a Google search. Because if they had provided this teacher's name on their woof bio as part of a practice for keeping woofers safe, if that name was provided, all you would have to do is type in a Google search, Marc Tizer, that's his real name, and you would pull up a dozen articles about what an unsafe person he is. And if people had access to that information, they could keep themselves safe, you know, and Woof could just say, hey, it's not our problem, we provided this information. That's fine. But if they're not going to provide that information, they need to do something to protect woofers, because otherwise you're putting young people in vulnerable positions in a place they've never been with people they've never met. Like, it's very easily a nightmare in the making if people aren't kept safe. And it's so easy to leave a good impression or to create a good image when so many of these wolf bios read like an advertisement of like almost, you know, this magical experience you're going to have. And then they handpick who they're going to ask to leave them a review. So every review is glowingly positive because the people that didn't have a positive experience don't have access to leave a review. So yeah, Woof does a terrible job in my experience. And at least on the intentional community website for the Foundation of Intentional Communities, when you go and look at those community descriptions, they give you way more actual tangible information about the community. They tell you who owns the land, how many people live there, is there an identified leader, how do they make decisions, what is their, how do they make their income, do they share it, how much of their own food do they produce, what are their actual spiritual practices. Like, all of this information would be a better indicator for a woofer of what's actually happening than what you see on Woof, which is just pretty much like opening up a travel magazine and reading about a hot destination that, you know, someone's trying to sell you, which is what it feels like with the bios and the reviews. And it's a lot of just glossy language with no real tangible information that a woofer could use to actually protect themselves.
And I would think also all of the things that you've mentioned sound perfectly reasonable to me. And it also, you know, you are reliant on this community. You're relying on them for all of your human needs while you're there, but also sometimes on transport as well. So it's not like an easy way for you to leave. So I just don't understand why there's not more of a duty of care through organizations like Woof, particularly if you've brought these kinds of concerns to their attention. It just is kind of astounding to me. And as someone who has researched divine madness before, like, I know that there are many stories out there that are very easy to find, that you can learn about the problematic elements of this community. I just think there should be a greater duty of care there. I find it quite shocking. And so let's rewind a bit to your own personal experience with what happened with you. You mentioned that you reached a point where you said that you could not watch these teachings anymore, which sounded very reasonable to me considering what the teachings were teaching. And so what happened then?
Yeah, so I was pretty much aware at this point that it was a cult, but I was simultaneously in denial. So the denial kind of won, I guess. And I thought that if I told the community at the dinner where everyone's present that I didn't want to watch the videos anymore, that if I just said it really tactfully and compassionately, there would be no problem. So I made that announcement and just said, yeah, this doesn't really resonate with me. I think I'll just eat my breakfast alone whenever you guys are watching the videos over breakfast. And I just thought that I could again, kind of just trying to do my own thing and ignore the glaring problem. And I thought that was going to be fine. And when I announced that, there was like dead silence. And then they just changed the subject. Like, I don't think anyone even addressed it or responded at all. And then the next morning, the woman who was kind of my boss, who was in charge of the garden, she came and told me, that's not going to work for us. And I was really confused. And she said, oh, we don't want you to feel excluded. And I was like, don't worry, I'll be fine. I'm totally fine eating breakfast alone. And she's like, no, it's not fine. And so then at first they suspended the videos for breakfast. So we did our breakfast together and there were no videos, which I was uncomfortable with because that's not what I said I wanted to do. So I already felt like I was kind of being forced in a certain direction. And then for the next week, I had all of these one-on-one conversations with like half of the community where they were all having this, you know, real like sweet tone, sitting me down and being like, hey, so let's talk, like what's going on? And just like this tone of concern, talking to me about why I don't want to watch these videos. And then the rhetoric I was receiving was what I now know to be mind control thought reform tactics, which was all like, what if you don't know what's best for you? What if you don't know your own truth? What if your trauma is what's informing your decisions and you're really just resisting discomfort, healthy discomfort that could help you grow? Mm-hmm. And you're just resisting change and you're not willing to do the work and you don't know what's best for you. And you just need to surrender to your higher power, and all, which really what they meant is surrender to Yo, the teacher, and just on and on from so many people. And then the real kicker was when I had my final healing session with that healer lady, and she did the same thing. She supposedly balanced me. She said, your head's not on straight, that's why you've been acting this way. She balanced me. And then she said, you know, just the same thing, trying to talk me into watching these videos. And at this point, I was shaken up. Like I definitely felt so confused and lost and like freaked out and unsure of myself, and everything just felt really wrong and off, and I didn't know what to do or what to think. But I knew I had like the one thing that I knew for sure was that I didn't want to watch these videos. So I just kept saying no. And this healer lady was like literally yelling at me. She's like, I don't understand. You're just like him. You're exactly like him. Because she had been telling me that me and Yo have the same energy and all this different stuff, just all this manipulation. And she was kind of freaking out. So after that supposed healing session where she couldn't change my mind, then like, I think 2 days later, she met up with me and she told me that she couldn't continue the healing sessions if I'm not going to watch the teachings, because the teachings are an integral part of the healing. So I can't do OES anymore. And if I'm not doing OES, then I need to leave the farm, leave the cult. And I was really shocked and upset because I had felt like these people were my friends. I really, really felt that way. And I felt such a strong connection to that land. And I really wanted to be there. So being told that I had to leave, it felt like it was like one more tactic to try to get me to change my mind. And I just knew that I couldn't do it. So I felt, well, I guess I have to leave then. And I was a little bit afraid that they weren't going to let me leave, because I asked the girl who was my age, the other woofer, if she would give me a ride, because I don't have a car. So I was extra vulnerable because I had to rely on getting those rides. So I asked her if she would give me a ride, and she said, well, it doesn't seem right that you're leaving. So I don't really feel good about giving you a ride when it seems like you really should stay. Oh my So God. She told me, no, I'm not going to give you a ride. And at that point, I really started to panic, because I'm like, okay, they're kicking me out, but they're not going to let me leave. And I'm very much trapped here. And like, it just got pretty real. But then I made another announcement at the next community dinner, just saying, hey, in case you guys didn't know, I've been asked to leave. I'm looking for a ride to Silver City. If anyone can give me a ride, that would be really helpful. And I think by that point, the teacher guy was just seeing me as a threat to the whole social order of the whole situation, because I was, you know, not in perfect alignment with his teachings, and I wasn't speaking out against them whatsoever, but just the fact that I said, this doesn't resonate with me, was enough to make me a problem, you know? So I think at that point, they just thought of me gone. So the one lady said that she could give me a ride to Silver City. And then I think I was there for one more week after that. And then I left.
That sounds really pretty scary there for a little while. And I guess that last week or that last period must have been quite uncomfortable as well.
Yeah, it was pretty intense. And I just had to make, you know, kind of emergency last minute plans to figure out where to go. So I just booked a hotel in Silver City, and all I had was my bike. So when I got to Silver City, I was getting a hold of a bike trailer so I could actually carry all my stuff. And I was just going to bike 60 miles to this other wolf farm. And then I was at the hotel for like 2 days, and then I went to this campsite, and I was there for 4 days. And during that time, I finally followed my intuition and I Googled the group. And that's when I found out about all the sexual assault allegations, was just like a few days after I left. And that was when I started panicking the most, because I couldn't stop thinking about the other woofer girl who was there and was in total devotion and reverence to Yo, and had started meeting with him multiple times a week in the middle of the night by candlelight. And I was extremely concerned about her. And so I sent her an email with all this information, and I sent Woof the email with all this information. And that was kind of the beginning of me trying to see if there was anything I could do to protect her and protect future woofers from experiencing what I experienced, which was hard enough, just like getting really close to a community of people and then being kicked out and ostracized and cut off, which was very painful because I did feel so close to so many of those people. That's one thing. But then to experience actually being in relationship with the teacher and all the ways that he was harmful toward people, that's a whole nother level, you know? And I just was so concerned about what could happen to this other woofer or, you know, anybody else. So, yeah.
Yeah. And I guess that's what's kind of driven you to do this interview, to try and make sure that other people are aware of the dangers of this organization and that they don't find themselves in that sort of situation. That's right, isn't it?
Yeah. I just think that people need to be warned, because it's so easy when you first get there to fall in love with everything about it, the people, the land, the lifestyle in many ways. And that was my experience, was like, I knew there were some red flags, and I even told people, yeah, I think I'm in a cult, but it's a nice cult, you know? And I was just like really not understanding how much could be hidden under the surface. And I didn't realize that that's like how this works. They want to draw you in, and they will create this perfect image, this utopic experience. And then by the time you get out of there, it's going to mess you up. Even if you thought, oh, this isn't that bad, you know, whatever you convince yourself, like, and in some ways I got out of there unscathed, you know, and I have had nightmares about the experience for the last year. Like, it's had a huge impact on me. And yeah, I just think that the information is available to warn people, and they just need to be able to draw the connection that when they see scenic, secluded farm in the Gila, I don't even know if they call it the retreat anymore, but if they see those words, if they go to the Teachings of Value website, I want people to be able to attach those things to the name Marc Tizer, because if they can draw that connection, they will start to understand how unsafe that place is.
And I really want to thank you for taking the time to walk us through your experience and what happened to you. And I wondered whether you have any idea whether that young woofer is still there or not.
So I tried to stay in contact with her via email. And when I warned her, I, you know, sent her all the articles about Yo and warned her about what danger she could be in. She told me that she didn't want to talk to me anymore. She didn't trust me. And I reached out several months later, and she actually did respond and just said, I don't know how to feel about you, you know, something along those lines. And I reached out again, and she didn't respond. And she used to be, when I was in the cult, she was actually active on Instagram a little bit, which was definitely countercultural for the rest of that group. So she still had one little tie to the rest of the world. But in the last, you know, 6 months or so, she hasn't been active on Instagram. She hasn't responded to emails. And as far as I know, she's still there. And at this point, it will have been almost, what would it be? Almost 2 years that she's been there. So as far as I know, she's just kind of stuck right now.
And I would have strong suspicions about what she's being told about you and responding to you and having any kind of communications with you.
Right. Like she told me in one of those emails that she said, I know you are trying to hurt Yo, but all you really did was hurt the rest of us. Something along those lines, which to me was just made it clear, like she's being told how to perceive me and how to perceive my attempt to warn her. And I also highly doubt that she read any of the articles that I sent her, because she was probably instructed not to. So
I would think that's right. I don't want to keep you too much longer. You've spent a really good couple of hours with me and I really appreciate it. But was there anything else before we finish up that we haven't covered that you'd like to talk about?
The only thing that I wanted to mention from the questions that you had sent me earlier was about warning signs.
Yeah, go for it.
So, yeah, I mean, I could just talk for an hour about that, so I'm trying to be concise, but I think the big warning signs were when I found out they had a teacher and the fact that that information had been hidden on the Wolf bio and the website. Both of those were warning signs. Also, the fact that they live in such a remote place, but they talk on their website about how they want to bring their teachings to the world, but then they're completely isolated from the world. And also just not having that consistent internet access and phone access, that's just a red flag for isolation, which could be intentional, but even if it's not, it could still be a problem. And then having something that is helpful is having an exit strategy. And for me, I was extra vulnerable because I didn't have a car. And I also kept myself in a vulnerable position because I wasn't listening to my instincts. And when I had those intuitions that this teacher guy seems sketchy and concerned about him, I just ignored all of those. And I noticed enough red flags to see, oh, this is probably a cult. But I was deluding myself to think, oh, it's a nice cult and it's okay because everyone's so friendly and kind and treating me so well. And I didn't understand that that's like step one in the process of getting yourself really stuck. And the biggest thing with their website is just that they don't actually say what they really believe. They use a lot of pretty nice sounding jargon, but it's extremely vague and doesn't give you any actual information. Like they said, they draw from spiritual traditions, both ancient and modern, but then they don't name a single tradition that they draw from. So it's all really vague and it sounds nice, but it doesn't tell you anything about who they actually are. And it also doesn't speak to the history of how they got to know each other, how this group got founded. So there's just a real lack of transparency that I didn't know to look for that. But in hindsight, I realized that I really needed more information before diving into being there. So yeah, I think those are the main red flags, other than in the earlier part of the experience before it became super obvious that it was not a good situation.
Yeah, I think I think that's right. And it's really tricky though as well, because I think one of the issues with having listings on sites like Woof is that it gives it a sense of legitimacy. Like, I can understand why people might not necessarily be on the lookout for red flags if they've found an organization on one of these websites that sounds really appealing. So yeah, it's a shame that people have to keep this stuff in mind, but when there doesn't seem to be any action by these organizations to exercise any kind of duty of care, I suppose that's what we need to do, right?
Yep, pretty much.
Well, that's, I think that's all the questions I had for you. So I just want to thank you once more for getting in touch and for letting our audience and the wider society know what happened to you, so that they can hopefully be warned, and so that hopefully this same thing doesn't happen to more people as well.
Yeah, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Dairu wrote to me after we chatted and said the following: I have so much love and appreciation for everyone there, aside from Yo. They were genuinely kind, idealistic, intelligent, and deep-feeling people. The hardest part is knowing that their true selves are being suppressed, that they are suffering and isolated and routinely shamed for their feelings and desires. It is also painful to know that I probably won't see or hear from them again, since they've been made to discontinue communication. I miss them all the time and pray for their freedom and healing. This won't sound unfamiliar to listeners of this podcast. The connections that people make in these groups are genuine. There are truly wonderful people enmeshed in them. The shunning that occurs afterwards, because a leader can't tolerate those who do not feed into the system that idolizes them, is truly devastating. This is especially true for the shunned person, but I've heard many times from those who leave later how difficult it was for them to have to cut someone off as well. As Dairu mentioned, as a result of their complaints, the Woof listing for the retreat does now mention having a teacher. Here's what it says, quote, "We practice an intentional way of life geared toward cultivating personal and spiritual development and optimal health on all levels, chemical, structural, emotional, mental, and spiritual. Though our teacher lives in a separate home here, on and off during the year, he has no direct involvement in our intern program. On the other hand, we, the 12 full-time residents here, endeavour in an informal and non-obtrusive way to share with interns as much as we possibly can of everything we have learned over the past 35 plus years since purchasing this property." At the end of the Season 5 episode about Divine Madness, I had hoped that the 75-year-old Yo Tizer had changed his ways, with no recent media coverage suggesting otherwise. It's distressing to find out that this seems unlikely. I'm going to remind you what former devotee Michelle Herson said of Yo, having made a sexual assault complaint to the Boulder Police Department in 1997. Quote, "He has a system where he tries to seduce any woman that comes across his path without concern for their boundaries and sensitivities. Many women felt confused and violated by these interactions." Michelle also said there was little space for individuals in Yo's orbit to have a sense of self, and that he has emotional and psychological control over everyone around him. He's a manipulative, diabolical person. I took a look at the glowing reviews on the Woof website, which are indeed from people who spent 1 to 4 weeks at the retreat and likely had wonderful experiences. The boundary testing that happened in Dairu's case suggests that those who are tested and pass and remain keen to stay longer may find themselves with a different story to tell. My thanks to Dairu for sharing their story. It's through these personal experiences that we can better understand how these organisations operate and hopefully learn to recognise the red flags. It takes a lot for someone to speak out about this stuff, and I appreciate it, as I'm sure my listeners do too. This episode of Let's Talk About Sex was produced by me, Sarah Steele, and music was by Joe Gould. Grab yourself a copy of his soundtrack album, Nobody Joins a Cult, on Bandcamp or stream it on Spotify.